Hello and welcome to our homeopathy summit. My name is Marianne Canengies, and here with me today is my dear colleague Paolo Campanella from Italy. And I will be looking forward to a real great talk about how not to get lost on the path of learning homeopathy and how to find your personal way in this exceptional art of healing. Hello, Paolo. Thanks for being here.
Nice to meet you. Yes, I will talk about my experience, a small experience, 27 years of experience. Well, in my beginning, when I started my academic career as a student, a university student of medicine, I was a very positivistic boy, you know, very rational. So, of course, I was full of prejudices against homeopathy, but really strong prejudices. And so I do understand the people who also have these skeptics, not skeptics, skeptics is correct, prejudice people is different. Anyway, as I was rational and positivistic, I was fall in love with the more scientific subjects, for example, chemistry and physics and histology, anatomy, and also physiology. They seemed to me very, very clear. Oh, okay, that's medicine. I will be a good doctor. Okay, it's very good, this. But the first disappointment was when I met pathology, because in pathology you see a mess, it is not so clear, and the causes of diseases are not so clear.
Yeah.
So I found this misleading me. It was the establishment, it shaken me a bit, you know. And then at that point, the things got worse when I met therapeutics. This was very, very disappointing for me because, you see, from the scientific anatomy and physiology, you go to therapeutics and everybody has a different theory, everybody has a different way of treating, every different school, or each different school of medicine. I don't know if you know, Marianne.
Yes, of course.
And
it's the same in vet science, I tell you, absolutely the same.
So what happened? Yes, every consultant in each place, each doctor, each different physician has a different way of treating. Yes, some, and the theory is changing during time. After 10 years, they were in a way. Now, so I was really, it was a really the first crisis, professional crisis of my life at the beginning of my physician career. So then, at a certain point, I had to decide which specialty to find out in which direction to move in my career. I was very, very irresolute about this. And at the end of all, I decided to look into a book of homeopathy. But I was very shameful in doing this because I was full of prejudices. So I went to a bookstore and I remember I standing there, I read something, and it was a very good book. It was The Principle and Arts of Homeopathy of Herbert Roberts, Dr. Herbert Roberts. Very good book. And I was very lucky because otherwise there was just this chance for homeopathy to conquer me. This just on it, you know. And at the point, what happened, I thought it was a charlatan, but he didn't wrote as a charlatan. He didn't say homeopathy is a wonderful medicine and stop. He said, yes, it is a wonderful medicine, but there is a lot to study. It is dangerous if you do this, don't do that. Avoid to use the hypothesis in several cases, and so on, and so on, and study, and study, and study. This was strange. And moreover, I saw that in homeopathy, there is a principle. There is a principle, the law similar. It is astonishing. It's fulgurating me. And I also found a lot of other rational rational things in homeopathy. So I remember the clatter of the shops coming sometimes because I was standing there, I read all the book in 2 hours. Sometimes he came in me and said, because he was suspicious, she suspected me that I wanted to steal something, you know. But at the end, I closed the book and I say, this is a charlatan or is a genius, one or two, or is a charlatan or is a genius. And because I want to do this, I go deeper. And then, of course, I began as a patient. And then I decided to practice homeopathy, to study homeopathy. The fact was that I attended a classical homeopathic school. They trained me very well in theory, in Organon, in Kent, and so on, but not in practice, not in practice. So I opened my practice, and it was very difficult. I had not any supervisor, so I didn't have many results, a lot of successes. And it was very frustrating. I got rapidly in second crisis, third, the first for Babel of therapeutics, conventional therapeutics. The second is this one. And what happened? What happened that I decided to study more and to visit this and that school of homeopathy and this and that homeopathic physician. But it was a mess the same because it was a bubble. Also, this is a bubble, homeopathic bubble. Everybody say something, this is the method, this is what you have to do, but it is not clear, then you are not able to apply it. It was terrible. And also, I found there is a lot of egopathy in homeopathy. A lot of people. Their ego is like this. Instead, I do believe that ego should decrease. Should decrease and you get lower in your ego.
Yeah.
So what happened is that at that point I remember something very astonishing. I mean, they looked to share with you. I attended the seminar. There was a live case with a patient with a certain disease, objective disease, and there were seven homeopathic teachers of seven schools of homeopathy, and they could ask him. Of course, they were provided with all the medical documents, reports about this case. They made an anamnesis. They had a lot of time, just one day of this. At the end of the day, one live case, seven homeopaths, 10 remedies. Okay. So I think this is Babel. This cannot be. And this is a rule. In a certain way, it is a rule. So I thought, if a science man, unprejudiced man, or also a prejudiced man, would come here, what would he think about us? So that is why I do believe that the real problem, the real enemy of homeopathy is not the big pharma, the economic issues, I don't know, politicians. These are only peanuts. The real problem, the real issue is inside us. The real enemy is inside us. This is very important. At that point, I met Dr. Dario Spinelli. I met him in advance, some year before than that. Dr. Naspinetti is my master. He is an homeopathic physician from Switzerland. And he's very close to me. I feel I'm predestinated, just 1 hour from my home. I live in not part of Italy, close to Milan. And what happened is that he gave me a paper, a school test, at the beginning of that lesson. You know, I went to this classroom. There were, I think, 15 homeopaths. And it was a solved case of Nash. An on an objective and severe disease, not peanuts, not my mind existential problem only. Of course, also these are not peanuts sometimes. But you know, it was an subacute endocarditis. Okay, subacute endocarditis. And it was a solved case because Nash died in 1917, you know. What was, I was really impressed by the fact that at the time there were not many computers for repertorization, so only repertory. And I remained with my pen like this, without writing anything, because it was, there were only physical signs. No mind symptoms. I was trained on that matter, to solve using above all mind symptoms. But it was simply a weeping, a bit, there was a bit of weeping disposition, nothing else. Beside that, only physical symptoms, some local, some general, and some peculiar that you have to grasp. But what impressed me that I was like this, like, you know, what I can do? The paper was empty. And after 10 or maybe 15 minutes, 30% of my colleagues were able to solve the case. Without a computer, we were able to solve the case. This astonished me, it impressed me a lot. And then she said, now that a part of the classroom has been able to solve the case, let's wait how to do it. Let's wait a minute to arrive to this result. And this was, then I, at that point I decided, this will be my master, I will tie myself to this chair. And I think this is very important. I can tell you something about Dr. Dario Spinelli. He has founded a clinic. He's the leader of the world of this clinic, where he treats only with homeopathy, classical homeopathy, several cases, above all of cancer patients, oncological patients. He integrates homeopathy to allopathy, or by homeopathy he can decrease in a very evident way the effects of radiotherapy and the chemotherapy, and he can sustain the patient during all his disease is cure. And there are also some patients having results more advanced, more interesting results with homeopathy. Okay. So he's used to deal with several cases, and he must have results. So he has followed a very precise method to cure patients. His method it's because he belongs to a very direct lineage of homeopaths.
Yeah.
James Tyler Kent, his two important fellow students, Austin and Godwin, and then Pierre Schmidt, and then Künzli, that is master of Dr. Spinetti, and then Künzli. So it is a very direct lineage, a very classical lineage. And of course, in this I think that every homeopath, every school, every nation can provide its own contribution to homeopathy, because homeopathy is like a diamond. It has many facets, and each of us can give it its contribution. Contribution of Swiss homeopathy, because Pierre Schmidt was Swiss, and also Künzli, and also Dr. Dario Spinelli, is exactly the method, a pragmatical method, no clouds, but practical method. Okay, then I will talk you something about this. This doesn't mean that Dr. Dario Spinelli has not improved, integrated in his practice also, for example, Indian homeopathy. He has an active cooperation to Dr. Alok and Rajasam Parekh of Agra, very, very competent homeopaths. Maybe you know that. So he has integrated these aspects, but he has some roots, very ground bases, and he can share it to other colleagues. So that he has a team, he's a leader of team of homeopaths in Switzerland that follow the same method and him, and they do have results. And so this was very, very impressive for me because I was used to a bubble. You don't know. It was a really, really, I think you say you know, you say yes. Okay. So what happened? For example, at that time, there were some, I cannot share with you all the method. Of course, it is a classical method. And for many listeners, it is normal. But for many others, it is not. It was not for me. I'm very humble in this. Because it was in theory, but as in practice, I was not able to deal with patients. Then I wandered in this and that direction, and I found a bubble. The bubble of myopathy. So I can share you some hints that helped me, and I can help someone. Of course, the first anamnesis is essential. Of course, I'm not talking about acute case. I think I am talking about constitutional case. We have a lot of time more than Indian people. I've been in Agra twice for a long time, and I see the huge mass of people they meet. Now they have only a few minutes for them usually. So we have in Europe, and we have a lot of time. We can dedicate a lot of time to the patient, and the majority of patients come as to for a chronic condition because the most of them do. Of course, there are also acutes, but the majority is for chronic condition. So in this case, we have to take a lot of time for them. 2 hours, first consultation usually plus. And going in every detail and giving a lot of importance to Kent interrogatory. I don't know the English word for it. Kent anamnesis. He has a list of symptoms, a list of questions to address to patients in order to inquire them in every direction, physically, from the top of the head to the tip of the toes. So this is very important because in this way you can have the totality of the patient and you do not risk it to be in the danger of only grounding your prescription on mild symptoms. Also, mild symptoms are very important in this kind of method, of course. But they are used to decide finally, to the differential diagnosis. But the physical important symptoms and the miasmatic symptom should match. And the second point, interesting, is not the analysis. After the anamnesis, it is an intermediate, very important point, that is the collection of symptoms. It means noting everything the patient has said that it seems to be a symptom, but you do not know what it is. It is something that I use to call the materia medica of the patient. You write down the symptoms. Because if you go deeply directly to the repertory, you will compress the phenomena directly in something that maybe it is not correct, even because the rubric you just know are not so much. So simply the fact, staying on the fact, this is very important, the collection of symptoms. And then you analyze them and you make a hierarchy from the first at the point that there are 153 peculiar striking symptoms, 153 paragraphs. Symptoms, then the mind symptom, well described and sure mental symptom, not maybe, but you have to be sure, okay? And then general, well observed and causes and then locus. And in and then you repertorize. And the other important thing that impressed me a lot is that in repertorization, you do not put only the essence, only the theme. You put the symptoms. You put the symptoms. This is the key. It changed my practice. And the fact is that if a patient have a hangnails, for example, hangnails, it is a symptom. It is also a miasmatic symptom. And usually in some, this is what I did before, but this is not important. No, it is not correct. You should put it inside. And also put everything is important of the totality in the same repertorization. Then you can make a smaller repertorization. But when you do a single repertorization as a rule, you have the, I want to say, the map of the vital force of the patient. It is like the genome map, you know, the genome map, genetic map. Mm-hmm. Okay, and in this repertorization, you will find some remedies at the top and so on. And you will also find some symptoms missing. And then you can think about this, because maybe if you make a smaller repertorization only with these missing symptoms, you will find a miasmatic remedy or a underlapped remedy, for example. You put also in a totality of sepia, patient is sepia, I mean, for example, and you have that this patient has a 1 foot cold and another foot hot. Okay, but it is not in the essence of sepia. Anyway, it is a fact. And if you do in this way, you will remember at the point where you will look at the symptom, maybe you will find conium. And you will ask, but for example, have you ever had some injury in your breast where you have a nodular cancer? And she could say yes. Mm-hmm. You understand, it is very important. Of course, not direct question as I've done, not yes, no questions. So this
yes,
is only.
Yes, very important, very important. And if you wanted, you could ask the color for confirmation of the case.
The color?
The color, yes.
Yes. Yes, 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 of course. And moreover, another interesting point is the potency. Of course, there is not a rule because sometimes you have to give an organotropic or the disease is severe, you have to be very careful and you have sometimes to repeat. I mean, a rule. In a constitutional case, as when you understand the remedy, you are convinced of the remedy, and you can do it because it is not a severe case, you give an exam. Mm-hmm. Also changed my practice, and it works much better. You go deeper into the vital force. It is very important. And in Europe, we give all the tube. There is a tube, I don't know if it is also in Germany or in Austria. In Italy, we have a tube like this with maybe 200 pills, small globules. Mm-hmm. And we prescribe to the patient, do like this, and then to put everything under your tongue. And this is not what Hahnemann says, and not what Dr. Spinetti says. He says just 3 globules, or maybe 2. He also only one. The only, we say 3 because we are superstitious. We do not believe that one can work. But anyway, this changed also my practice, even because, for example, talking about sepia patients, I have some 2 or 3 sepia patients. They seem for me sepia, and I give them in this way, in the other, the old way, old manner, the remedy. But the reaction was bad, and I believe this is not the remedy. And then I change it and I dance around the materia medica. You know that kind of patients you go around.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
From that on, at the point when I met Dr. Spinetti, I said no. I restarted that case and I said no. According to me, it is sepia, and we will give these patients 3 pills, and everything changed. Everything that was the similimo. It was very impressive and very instructive for me. And moreover, this is something that. I have some notes, because I don't want to miss anything. There are many other things. For example, two potencies he uses in a very this is a way, I don't know if you want to speak about this or, but anyway, it is a long story. Let's go on, and if the case, I come back to this. So in my opinion, it is very, 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 very important for each of us to start from homeopathic roots. We have like trees, we have to be rooted into the ground. And we have not to invent again the wheel. The wheel has just been invented. This is not to be too much conservative. I do not believe that we have to be in a narrow place that we cannot go in another direction. Homeopathy is like life. We have to be free, but because the patient does are what they are. But in my opinion, it is very important to have very deep roots. And we know that in these roots, if we follow this method, it does work. And after having practiced and after having been trained in this method and practiced it, then we can say, this is what I can do with this method. And then I can try something else, some theory, some other, because nobody has the truth at all. And so my suggestion to younger homeopaths is to study possibly with a good teacher or if they are very lucky, with a few masters that there are in the world, there are not so much, and to learn homeopathy, and then to have a supervisor that can help him to join, to make the bridge between theory and practice. It is very important. And it is very important to avoid to go into the clouds of theories. In my opinion, this is only my opinion, my humble opinion, is that the most important ego in life is ego. The most enemy life is ego. And when I had my degree in medicine, I was very proud. I had a lot of ego. And I said, now I will conquer, not the world, but like when one is young. And all the obstacles I met taught me a lot, really a lot. And what I understood at this point is that I can express you in this word. I asked my patient, for example, have you ever concentrated your mind on your right foot, for example? And then you say, no, doctor, I've never. And you know why? No, why? Because your right foot has never been painful. If it is painful, your mind is always on it. You say you have to go to the bar, to the restroom, to the bathroom. No, let's wait an hour because it is so painful to go there. So the health of the foot is forgetting the foot. And this is also the health of the leg, of the thigh, of the chest, of the eyes, and so on. You do not remember your ear if they are not painful, they are not too hot, and so on. And this is the same of your ego, of the issues you have in your life. The more you are healthy, the more you forget yourself. And I think this is very important. And also remember a sentence of Patanjali. Patanjali is the founder of Raja Yoga, an important yoga master of ancient times. And he used to say that life, that mind is like a diamond. He becomes the of the color of the object on which he is pushed on. If you bring your mind on something brown, it becomes brown, and so on. The problem is that we also add our ego, and we have imperfection, and we do not see the things as they are. We do not disappear at all. But the more you are able to disappear, the more you will be able to cure, because the more also you will be able to perceive the patient. So you should disappear. It is not important to you. Homeopathy is only a bridge. The importance is in homeopathy and the patient. And also the patient during the process of cure will forget himself more, because he will be more in touch with what it is, what with now, what is now and here. This is my actual idea of health. So it is important also that homeopaths and teachers in homeopathy make the same. This is one of the most important quality of Dr. Spinelli. He disappears. He's only for homeopathy for his patient. It is correct. It is I'm not venerating him, but if you know him, you know that he is this. He is this.
I have the pleasure to see him in lectures, and I know exactly what you mean. Yeah. He teaches us how to serve, how to really serve being a homeopath and to align to the life force.
Yes, and if you want, if not, I don't know if we have time left, I can tell you something about another subject that is of course connected, but because everything is connected with homeopathy, in homeopathy, that is communication in homeopathy.
Yeah, yes, of course.
Yes. Okay. So the issue is, the fact is that when I was a young homeopath many centuries ago, in a wedding banquet, you know, there is someone that don't know you, doesn't know you, and they ask you, what do you do? And I'm an homeopath. What is a homeopathy? And I began from Cinchona officinalis, from the kind of delusion and so on, the experiments. And after 15 minutes, the person slept, you know, like this. It is not the right way. We have two brains, two half brains, or better, we have two functions in our brain that is a whole. But we can say, to simplify, we have a left brain that is a rational brain, and the right brain that is a more creative, imaginative, and so on. In the healthy condition, we should use both. And we have talked I've talked about the method. Method is very rational, very left-brained. Even if in it there are many creative processes, and you know, but as a whole, it is a method, and there are a lot of things that we can match with the left brain. Also in homeopathy, we have to study, we have to arrange our office, we have to make research, of course, and so on. We have many issues of left-brained issues in homeopathy. But we also have a right brain, otherwise we use only half a brain, it is not a good idea. And I think that the most important issues, the most important problem we have in homeopathy in order of importance, one, ourselves. I've just told about this subject. The second problem is the implausibility of homeopathy. It is not plausible. It is counterintuitive. It is against intuition. It is against our apparent common sense. And this is very, very important. So it is easy to consider it a quackery. We cannot get angry with people making this. Yes, of course, some of them make it out of money, but it is not so important. The most important thing is the cognitive bias that we know. Also, we have a cognitive bias, but it is not possible to conquer a cognitive bias with left brain, because it is a delusion. And we have to apply the law similar. If you don't know that we are homeopaths, who can do it? We have to apply the law similar also to the delusion that is a prejudice. Otherwise, this is very, very, very important. So, for example, there is a friend of mine here, very dear friend of mine, it is a very good allopathic pediatrician. And he has prejudices against homeopathy, And I can show him anything, research. We all know this, have this experience. Researches and this and that, and cases. And if you, this kind of, this children, this child got a sickness, was sick every 15 days and now no more. Yeah, not he rebounds everything out. And he's in, he's not, I understand it, the delusion. We also have some delusion because we are not too much healthy also. So what can we do? The fact is, for example, I really do not believe that Earth is flat. I do not believe it because I know, I have experience of it. I know we have, we know it. But imagine that a person believing that Earth is flat comes to you, and tell you, okay, Marianne, I have some research about this. Go in PubMed or something. I mean, you go there. We have research now. We have the proof that it is not true. Will you go to spend your time on that research? I will not. I will not, of course, because I know that Earth is flat. My brain is charged with a lot of issues, a lot of information. We decide something that is once for the rest of our life. And because we have to save energy, time, and so on, we cannot solve that. We have a lot of motor schemes. You know? When I drive my car, I do not have to remember what I have to do to drive the car. So it's the same every. So we have to understand this. I think that the issue is that anyway, not for believing that the Earth is flat, but for homeopathy, because homeopathy is not a quackery. And the delusion of people, honest people, is that it is a delusion. Or some people, many others, no, but some people, many do this, do believe this. So we have to learn to use the right brain. And this is also true when someone asked me, what is homeopathy? Or when a patient asks me, it is very important to have to use metaphors. No, is it correct this word in English, metaphors, to make them understand with the right brain what is homeopathy? I make you some examples if you want. Mm-hmm. A person tells me, okay, I'm a patient of yours, or I met you in the bar, I don't know, in a coffee shop and so on. What is homeopathy? And now I say, I do not talk about the Cinquona officinalis, you know, but I say, listen to me, you have maybe 50,000 billions of cells in your body, you are made of them. And each of them is a laboratory. Each of them produces, I don't know, something like 500,000 chemical reactions each second. And each of the cell is has to cooperate to the other cell and has to know real time what happens in the other cells, and the cells near them, and also the cells of the tissue, of the same tissue, on the other tissue, on the organ, of the apparatus, and of the person as a whole. And then the person as a whole is the ruler of all the whole, because each organ has to serve the person. And the person also has to live a life, he has a menstrual cycle, he has a challenges, he has to adapt to cold, to damp weather, to exertion, to death of people, and so on. This is a giant challenge. And what we do? We do have a sort of director. We have a sort of CEO of a company, you know, that is a function working inside us and acting, coordinating all this without our intervention. This is my way of sharing what is a vital force. And so they understand this. And then I say, a nurse person can do everything. But if this director is not very well, each of us has some issues, some symptoms, this thing is not able to do, and this is not able to do. For example, I cannot adapt to wet weather, or you have painful menses, and so on. And so what happens? It is like if you are a student in a school test. If you are a student in a school test, what can you do? You have two choices available. Or you copy. You don't know the English word for it, no? There is your mate, your friend, and he gives you the paper with the solution. And in this case, that's all okay, but you will not learn it, man. You will not know that subject, and you will have a problem, because the next school test, you need him again and even more. And so if you are used to doing it this way, your career will be ruined. In the other situation, the other option, you go and study and take some lessons in order to learn, and then you will be able. Of course, in the second process, it is a bit harder. You have to learn. So this is important, because everybody do understand what are we dealing with, and even why I give only 3 pills and not every day. Maybe I give you just 3, and then I will see in 40 days. And moreover, I also share then the importance of the homeopathic cure as a process during time, and the concept of complex diseases. Because this is the case, we know the Ehring law, no? Or even if it is a complex disease, you give a remedy to the patient, and then something and all symptoms appear, and so on. But you have to explain to the people what happens and why they have not to suppress them, or why they have not to go to a dermatologist or to another specialist for another symptom different from the one for which they have he has consulted you. And so I say, imagine a thread of wool, a wool thread, and then you, I don't know the English word for it, huh? You like this,
you make a bundle, yeah?
Yes, it's correct. You make a, and okay. And the healthy person is like this with a ball that is perfect, is in order. A sick person is the same ball but tangled. Mm-hmm. Tangled. So, what a child will do to undevelop, to solve this tangled ball? Of course. He has like this, a ball like this, all in a mess. And he decided, okay, let's go in this way. This is the most important part for me. And he tries to draw it. But when he draws it, what happens to the left? And it succeeds, because this part comes to him. But the rest of the ball become more tangled. And after 10 days, he decides, no, now this is more important. And so he draws, and what happens? Succeed, but the rest is more tangled. So at the end of this process, you will have a lot of, like this, and like this, and then a ball that you can, so tangled that you cannot do anymore. You have to put it away, to throw it off. And so this happens when you cure without a method, without a clearness, the clearance of the method that is homeopathic method. When you do but with homeopathy, you start from the end of the bundle, that is maybe inside. But doing like this, as all the wool is connected, gradually everything changes. And so the patient is able to understand, because you talk by imagery, you talk by metaphors.
You talk in pictures, and you can imagine those pictures, and the pictures transport the idea.
You bring the patient gradually to understand, but also to agree what you are saying. It is not an ex-cathedra. No, you are the master, you are the guru, and better you do like this. And this doesn't work. Of course, this is possible. Probably, it is easier in Europe or maybe in USA, I don't know, because we have time, more time than in India. But in some cases, it could be very useful, in my opinion. And anyway, when we have to deal with, in general, if you want, we have to, not to fight, because to fight is contraria contraribus curantur, and it's not homeopathic. But we have to find a way to solve in a resonating way the problem of narration against homeopathy, because we have narration on behalf of mass media and of science institution and so on, and the reason for that is both of economic interests, not money interests, and power interest, but and also of proudness. I am right, you are wrong, because everybody, many people has this need to say their own frustration with their wife, maybe, and then they have to write something to someone telling him to be haters on this subject. Mm-hmm. But the most important is the cognitive bias. And so we should elaborate, develop a system of communication, of narration of our results, but not only a rational. For this, there are researchers, and then we have also to follow this path. I don't think that left brain is not right. I think that also right brain is right.
You have to combine it. You always can say the intellect and the practical sense is more on the left side.
Yes.
And the emotional side and the sense for community is more on the right side.
Yes.
And you have to combine them. And even use the instinct, which may be in the guts.
Yes, yes. I agree with you.
You have to use everything. And the very interesting story is that we both started as very good allopaths. Yeah. Lots of science and lots of understanding, wanting to understand medicine. And I met the same problem as you did. I did see more and more that medicine is not an exact science. 2 and 2 in medicine doesn't equal 4. It's something between 2.5 and 6.3.
Yes, of course, you are. I totally agree, because it is.
And I had the pleasure to be treated by an homeopath when I was ill at the end of my studies. Allopathy couldn't help me, and the homeopathy did help me in an instant. And so I was converted. I had this Saulus Paulus equation. And from there, I was very interested to learn this extraordinary helpful science. And as you did experience, I did see that there were a lot of more laws and facts that did not change. It was reliable, something I didn't find in allopathy. Same story.
I totally agree.
Same story. And later in my life, I had a near-death experience. I passed over and came back again, and that changed me totally. This was my possibility to drop the ego. To see that we are not infinite beings. On one hand, we are infinite beings, but our body is not.
Very wise.
There are a lot of important things that are true in eternity, and others that just don't matter, because they will vanish and go to ashes sooner or later, which is the sense of justice, the sense of being right. And I agree to you that a lot of problems are according to, let's say, power, dominance, and greed. This is something that mixes up mankind a lot. And I hope that sooner or later, by homeopathy, even our mental state and our soul and our way of living will get cured.
I do hope it.
Yeah.
But I think that also people who do not believe in homeopathy or hate with prejudices and so on, they are part of a totality, because we require them. No, we have not to fight. We have not to. It is senseless, in my opinion. I've understood this, of course, in the course of my life, and sometimes I'm not so wise. But I understand when I'm in peace that it is useless to punch the rain. Okay, because you simply obtain to wet your hands in advance, faster. In fact, the quality of rain is to fall down and to bath people. And so if it happens, there is a reason. So we have to adapt to this situation in a positive manner. And that is... Yes.
It is, as Buddha did teach us, it's a non-violent path to go, no matter what.
Yes. Yes, of course, the not violent way, also homeopathy is a non-violent way, because it is similar, mm-hmm. but it is the most powerful.
Yeah.
Yes, it is the most powerful.
Paulo, thank you very much for this interview. Are there any last words you want to address to our listeners?
No, not specifically, but I'm very happy to have shared my story, and my humble story, and my experience, my ideas, my small ideas.
Yes, so we will take from you that when you go and want to learn homeopathy, select a guru, select a master, select a teacher, and make a wise choice.
Yes, and it is a very challenging choice, because it is not so easy to choose it. You have to find it. You have to wonder if it is the correct one. You have to ask yourself, is it right or not? To investigate, and maybe you have to make some kilometers more.
Yes, and the life force will lead you if you let it.
Yes.
The life force will lead you to your specific teacher.
And one of the most important is that you can judge a teacher from the results of his students.
Results of work and results of students and way of teaching.
Definitely. It's very easy to make theories. The most important thing is if you obtain results. If you obtain results, in my opinion, this is the last thing I want to say. I do not believe that Organon is a Bible. Of course, Hahnemann, if he would have lived 10 years ago, 10 years more, he would have written something more, of course. But anyway, he was the most competent homeopath ever lived. This, I'm sure about it. And what I mean is that if you want to consider yourself a classical Hahnemannian homeopath, you should follow Organon. And on that path, then you can change something and develop about on the path of Hahnemann. You cannot say, yes, I'm an Hahnemannian homeopath, but I do not follow 144 paragraph that states that Materia Medica has to be built on solid basis, on ground basis, and not in theories, in fantasies. This is very important. Otherwise, I think you could develop a better physician. You will have a new method, better, but it is not an animal. Do not say that you are following animal. You are making something better. Okay, I agree, I respect you. This is very important, because this is part of the bubble we live in now. And I do believe that bubble is not good nor for classical and Alemannian homeopathy and for those who are not, who I respect.
Yes, we definitely need to be clear what we are talking about. Paulo, thank you very much and have a very happy day today.
Thank you. You too.
Bye. See you.